beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness. And that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess sin with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of heavenly grace, saying after me. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like poverty. We have followed too much devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no help in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thy heart, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thy love that is unpenitent, according to thy promises, declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that they may hereafter live a holy, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please in which we do at this present, and the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. first reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 27 to the end. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God and the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and he strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with the wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the end of the first lesson.
The second reading is from John 12, verses 20 to 26. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour." It endeth the second.
Lord be with you,
and with thy spirit.
Teach us to know your Son, Jesus Christ, as the way, the truth, and the life, that we may follow the steps of your holy apostles, Philip and James, and walk steadfastly in a way that leads to your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour.
Amen.
Light in our darkness we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Our next hymn in the New English Hymnal 164, Twin Princes of the Courts of Heaven.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus, you turn the despair and dismay of his disciples into joy and peace. When you broke through the evil of the cross and made your followers sure of your victory. In that knowledge they found courage when they might have been afraid, hope when everything seemed to go wrong, and an overwhelming happiness when they would otherwise have known only sadness. There are often things which make us afraid, things which go wrong, things which make us sad and sometimes full of doubt. Come into our lives with your joy and peace, and help us to share the victory of your presence, not only for our sake, but so that your life may be seen in us. Amen. Jesus said, "How blessed are the peacemakers." We pray for all men and women who have the job of making peace in our world, the leaders of nations who sit around a table and discuss ways of living together, the diplomats of the world who are to be the ambassadors of courtesy and understanding, the men and women of the United Nations organization and its agencies, which seek to bring men and women closer together in peace. Jesus said, "How blessed are the peacemakers. God shall call them his sons." May all those who work for peace know your strength and encouragement, which comes from the depths of peace Jesus promises us in his Spirit. Merciful Father, accept these prayers through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. And our next hymn is number 464 in New English Hymn Book, "Thou Art the Way by Thee Alone." Speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, today we celebrate St. Philip and St. James. And James, the son of Alphaeus, saints, and I would say we know absolutely nothing about saint, and James, son of Alphaeus, we know nothing about him apart from his name, and that he was one of the 12 chosen by Jesus. So he was a very important man in the church, one of the 12 pillars of the new Israel, his church. He was not the James of the Acts, the son of Clopas, brother of Jesus, and later Bishop of Jerusalem. James, the son of Alphaeus, was also known as James the Lesser. To avoid confusion with James, the son of Zebedee, also an apostle, known as James the Greater. Must be a bit awful, wouldn't it? We call the Lesser. You know, I'm not sure I'd like that, really. Terry the Lesser. Never mind. Anyway, Philip also came from the same town as Peter and Andrew, Bethsaida in Galilee. Jesus called him directly, whereupon he sought out Nathanael and told him, "The one about whom Moses wrote was here." Like the other apostles, Philip took a long time coming to realize who Jesus was. On one occasion, when Jesus saw the great multitude following him and wanted to give them some food, he asked Philip where they should buy bread for the people to eat. And St. John comments, Jesus said this to test him, because he knew what he was going to do. And Philip answered, 200 days' wages worth of food would not be enough for each of them to have a little. John's story was not a put-down to Philip. It was simply necessary for these men, who were to be the foundation stones of the church, to see the clear distinction between humanity's total helplessness apart from God and the human ability to be a bearer of divine power by gift of God. On another occasion, we can almost hear the expiration of Jesus' voice after Thomas had complained they did not know where Jesus was going. Jesus said, "I am the way. If you know me, then you will also know my Father, from whom on you do know him and have seen him." And then Philip said, "Master, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." And Jesus answered, "Have I been with you for so long a time that you still don't know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." Possibly because Philip bore a Greek name, or because he was thought to be close to Jesus, some Gentile proselytes came to him and asked him to introduce them to Jesus. Philip went to Andrew, and Andrew went to Jesus. Philip's reply in John's Gospel is indirect. Jesus says that now his hour has come. That is the short time, but in a short time he will give his life for Jew and Gentile alike. I always find that passage a bit sort of strange. When Philip asks the question, and Jesus gives an almost different, well, he doesn't answer his question, but gives another statement. I always think it's a bit like cut and paste. You know, when John was doing his gospel, you know, he started something and then he perhaps went away and then started again. But I don't know. Maybe not. But those two apostles, two followers of Jesus, were so important. through that early church. Today in the Gospel reading for this morning, it's the story of the lakeside appearance of Jesus, and then Jesus sort of really confronting Peter. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Peter, are you sure you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. And then Jesus says a third time, by which time Peter is getting a bit agitated, I think. And he says, yes, Lord, you know I love you. You know everything. And Jesus says, feed my sheep. That is important for all of us. We are to be disciples of Jesus. We are, all of us, to feed his sheep. All of us are to pass on our knowledge of Jesus Christ to those who are willing to listen and hear the word of the Lord. Those early disciples, many of them became martyrs, many of them gave their whole lives to proclaiming the gospel. And it is remarkable how the early church grew in strength, vitality over the first few years. First, maybe 100 years after Jesus' resurrection. Sometimes I hear people today saying, oh, you know, the church is dying and all that sort of thing. Well, I think all of us go, all organizations go sometimes through difficult periods. And maybe the church at times gets things wrong. But the basic message of Jesus Christ is always right. It is always. It always needs to be passed on. And I believe that the church will grow. I do believe the church will survive. I do believe that Jesus is word will be with generations to come for many more years than we're around, anyway. Amen. We're going to stand now to sing our final hymn, which is New English Hymnal 252, The Day That I Gave Its All Is Ended.
Thank you.
Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.